Hey, hey, Husker and Creighton fans. It's the Half Court Press Podcast. Sam McKeown along with Wilson Moore on a Wednesday. Stony Brook Wednesday. Wilson, got a game tonight.
Yeah. That's hard doing this over Zoom, not in the office today. But yeah, Nebraska's kind of light non-conference slate continues. Lindenwood, Florida A&M, Rider, now Stony Brook tonight.
What have the meals been like so far at PBA, the pregame meals?
They've been great. I had heard from a couple people going into this that was the best media food the University of Nebraska had to offer was at PBA, and it's delivered. Last week or 2 nights ago, Monday, it was some pulled pork sandwiches, coleslaw. It was and spaghetti and meatballs last week. It's been a
wow.
Yeah, it's been two thumbs up so far.
That's good. How do you think you've watched three games. What do you think of the basketball so far? They've won two games real handily, and then, you know, they struggled a little bit against Rider, but not a ton.
Yeah, you know, I think we saw that they can win in different ways. I think we saw this as the potential to be a very good defensive basketball team, particularly against Rider. You know, they were not good offensively. Fred Hoiberg said as much. Much after the game, they struggled from the outside. They had a lot of kind of trying to put a square peg into a round hole, you know, taking the ball to the basket when Ryder was collapsing on it, on everything. But, you know, they did enough, and there will be days like that, you know, and especially in the early season, non-conference part of the season where a team shows up and, you know, you're just not making shots. Things aren't at 100% offensively, and when you can win that game, you know, by 14 points, and they went on a 17-0 run at one point, kind of put it away. Ryder went 9 minutes without making a basket. When you can do that in a game where you're not at your best offensively, that's a good thing for Nebraska. With that said, you know, if they play like that offensively in a Big Ten game, they're not going to win that. But, you know, I mean, it's November. We've seen a couple different kind of sides of this team, and, you know, three wins so far. So it's hard to, at this point in the season, you know, question the result.
Yeah. Speaking of Big Ten, so two of Nebraska's upcoming opponents played each other last night, Creighton and Iowa, and what I would describe as a fun game, 92-84, Blue Jays. I was impressed with what Creighton did in some areas. I think if the first half wasn't as good as it could have been, I think in the second half they had some extraordinary stretches in the second half and then toward the end of the game. One of the things that I've learned covering sports, I'm not a college athlete, but you get a sense of like watching these things. When a team decides they've won the game and there's still 4.5 minutes left, that's a dangerous time. Because what they've determined is, hey, we're a better team. So we just like the game to end now. And then Iowa made some shots, you know, and made it interesting at the end. But it was really about a 12 to 14 point game that got a little tight late, you know, and Creighton won by 8. But it was about the correct spread. It was about 12. I think Creighton went into the game as a 12.5 point favorite, something like that. That was about right. You watched the game last night. Nebraska does not look like they would beat those two teams right now, does it?
No. I wouldn't say so. Yeah, those were two talented teams, two teams that can fly up and down the court. That was one thing that struck me, is just how fast that game moved. I think you could tell Creighton just had a little more. Creighton had a little more juice. You know, which especially in those last, you know, kind of 4 minutes as I was making, you know, that late push made it kind of interesting. They just. Creighton was so good offensively. Iowa just couldn't get the stops they were going to need to get back into that game. And that was what really stood out to me.
One thing I'll say is that both Creighton and Iowa basically went into the game with an understanding they were going to get up and down the floor. Right? Yeah. Those two coaches are friends. They've played each other before. So I one thing I will say is that Nebraska would not enter into that gentleman's agreement. There would have been a time early in Fred Hoiberg's tenure when they would have. And they would have said, well, yeah, let's fly up and down the court. You guys will win by 19 and we'll have a good time. Nebraska's changed who it is. It's changed its DNA. And of course, it swept Iowa last year, a team that most people would say is more talented than this Iowa team. But what I struck me last night, a couple things on the Creighton front. One, you know, they do play a little bit more open than they did even last year. Now, Ryan Nembhard was really fast and gets up and down the floor and is doing that for Gonzaga. I don't know what he did last night, but he had a really good first game. But, you know, this is an offense that will throw it down the floor. They will pass it, skip pass it, get out in front. They're already playing the angles, you know, 3 seconds into a possession. You know, I'm not talking a steal above the three-point line, but a carom off the rebound, one pass, two pass, shoot. And that's a little different than they had last year. It's more like what they had 4 or 5 years ago. And, you know, Shireman, I think Baylor Shireman looks like a different player. Maybe he shaved a little bit of weight. I don't know. He shaved his head. But he just looks different. I think he's going to benefit most from this kind of structure because he can get out and hit shots early. And it's not a lot of half-court structure. A lot of time with Nembhard, he's going to get the ball. People are going to throw it to him. He's going to dribble down the floor. He's going to get about 4 feet away from the rim. Then he's going to pull it out. Then they're going to run half-court offense. Then they have to decide what they want to do. You know who that benefited? Kalkbrenner.
Yeah.
And I think he's still working through this. Now in the second half, I thought Kalk played really well. Really well. Like he ran the floor, got a couple of, you know, beat either Cricky or somebody else down the floor from Iowa. And that's the Kalkbrenner that, you know, you gotta have to see in the NBA. Because you get in the NBA and the defenses are too good. Kalkbrenner's not gonna get, you know, lobs at the rim or he's gonna dunk. He's gonna have to run the floor, he's gonna have to make threes. And so like some of what we saw in the second half is the Kalkbrenner that I think he could be. In the first half, they're struggling to get him the ball. They were doubling him, you know, or they're bringing a second guy down, Creaky in back, somebody else in front. And it's just hard to get him the ball. And he can't, you know, he's still not comfortable with the three-point shot because he turned a couple down. So that's an area where he's still kind of growing. But I thought I thought Creighton did a really good job of just spreading the floor, getting some early threes. And then once you're able to spread a team out a little bit, it's not unlike football. Then all of a sudden you get your run game. And I've always called the run game basically getting to the rim. And once you spread everybody out, then Trey Alexander can go to work, you know, and he can go right up the gut of a defense. I thought he did a nice job. Got even better in the second half, but I thought he did a really nice job of making a number of those things happen. What'd you think of Iowa?
They were intriguing. Kind of a different, you know, different Iowa team. You know, the Murrays are gone. Connor McCaffrey's gone. I hadn't seen a whole lot of Ben Cricky up to this point. You know, didn't watch a ton of Valpo basketball last year. He's got a real kind of old school game. You know, kind of LaMarcus Aldridge. You know, mid range. And you know, I know those aren't really the high efficiency shots, but when you make them like he does and what he appears capable of doing, they are for him. I'm really interested. Right. I mean, looking at this from a Nebraska perspective, he and Rink Mast those two will be a really interesting matchup for me, both with, you know, kind of their stylistic differences and similarities in how they play and just, you know, narrative wise, two guys from the MVC now in the Big Ten. Iowa was interesting. I think I thought they played as well as they could have against a team as good as Creighton. I thought they hung with them about as well as could have been reasonably expected of them.
So I think those are all really good analytical points. One thing I'll say is that Creighton's going to accept, and I mean, they almost lost, I guess. They didn't almost lose. They didn't. They control the entire second half. Creighton's going to accept a team that wants to shoot 15-foot to 18-foot jumpers all night long. If they make a lot of them, great. But there were key moments in the second half where I was either trading the two for the three or they were trading a missed two for a three. And so Creighton runs that, what they call that drop coverage, where Kalkbrenner's going to sink to the rim. He's going to protect the rim. He's not going to give you the 75% shot, but he'll give you the 48% shot from 16 feet, and Cricky made a lot of it. I don't know that Nebraska will give that shot. I don't know. We'll have to see how it all kind of plays out. I know that Nebraska has been very comfortable doubling the post at Iowa and letting those guys shoot threes and kind of saying, okay, well, if you hit them tonight, if you hit 14 of these tonight, you're going to beat us. If you hit four, we'll win. And they've done that a couple of times successfully under Hoiberg, twice, actually. And then last year, they went into Carver Hawkeye and just outgunned them. And they just hit a bunch of shots and beat them. That's the third time that Hoiberg's beaten McCaffrey. So there's some of that for sure there, this notion of like, we're going to give you that shot. If that's what you're going to make tonight, we're not going to give you the three easy, and we're not going to give you the at the rim. And eventually, Iowa missed some. And then Creighton went down and hit shots. What I'll say is that's the best Patrick McCaffrey's ever played. I don't know what he had last night. Right? What do you have? That's the best ball game I've seen him play. What were his numbers? I'll have to look it up. But I thought he played outstanding, and he got it at the rim, right? He got it right there at the rim. He had 13, three assists, two blocks, two steals. Best basketball game he's played. And he's playing really well this year. And I don't know if it's that his brother's gone or whatever it is, but this guy is, I mean, that's a different player. Cricky won't get that every night. And their guard play is just so. And you kind of saw that as the game went on. Like, yeah. I think Nebraska can get into the gills of that backcourt and can make some things happen. Now, they're young. The Harding kid's good. He's a rookie. They've got some pieces in the backcourt, but they're going to have to lean a lot on Patrick McCaffrey and Cricky, I think. And then one of the Sanfords, the older one, Peyton, he can shoot the three for sure. I thought Creighton played, you know, in the second half, played about as good as it could for certain stretches. That's Creighton basketball, you know.
Yeah.
They get stops, they hit threes, they run out, Colt gets two jams, you know, building goes wild. It's a tough place to play and a tough place to win. And it was a big day for the Big East. I don't know if you watched the previous two games. Marquette's just better than Illinois.
Yeah, I thought Illinois played well in that game. I think similar to what I was saying about Iowa, I thought Illinois played about as well as it could have and made that as close as they could have against.
Maybe Coleman Hawkins can play better than that.
Yeah,
I think Coleman Hawkins is the player on that team that whether they win big games or they lose them, it's not Shannon, it's Hawkins, and he missed some shots. I think Brad Underwood probably walked off that court going, you know, damn it, we should have won. Like I just don't think Illinois thinks of it that way. I think they're like, we should not lose unless we're playing on the road and we're playing a really good team. Like, I don't think Illinois thinks about losing games to number four Marquette. I'm sure they had designs on winning that game by 10. They didn't. And then Wisconsin got run off the court.
Oh, yeah. Close.
Now, that happens sometimes up there. Regardless, and now I know they got Kimmy English up there, but that happened a lot under Ed Cooley where Providence was just run somebody off the court. I mean, it was – they had a crowd. They'd win by 24. I mean, Wisconsin didn't look like they were. But you know what? That's the Wisconsin that I've known for the last 4 or 5 years. That team doesn't go places to win big games. They win at home. They'll go early in the season, and they'll win a neutral site game in Hawaii or the Bahamas. They don't win the big ones on the road. They just don't do it. Do you watch that? Is it Wisconsin, your family is Wisconsin alums?
Yep, I did. I watched the first half. I knew it was a long evening of Big Ten basketball ahead of me. You know, I think that game started at like 5. So I was, you know, don't burn myself out on Wisconsin Providence when the final result is guaranteed by halftime. So I watched I watched a chunk of that, then tuned back in for Illinois Marquette and Creighton Iowa.
Yeah, that was interesting. I'm going to look at their schedule here real quick. I don't know what they're doing playing some of the games they're playing. I don't think they're good. They think they're good, obviously. But, I mean, help me out here, Wilson. Help me out. Just help me out. What in the hell are they doing playing UVA, SMU, West Virginia, Marquette? Well, they're playing Marquette every year. In Arizona, what are they doing?
That's feels like a lot. That's a lot of faith in like Connor Asigian making the leap and Stephen Crowell progressing. They're just, it's kind of
I mean,
felt
I
like
think
over
I
the.
just, I think I just rattled off. Let's see, they already have two losses. They played a tennis. They played Tennessee.
Yep.
I think I just rattled off three, four, five, six loss. I don't know what they're doing. They could be 5-6 going to the Big Ten. Anyway, let's move on to Nebraska Creighton women's basketball. You can ask any questions you want here. They renew their rivalry on Sunday, and Nebraska's shorthanded. They are going into this one most likely without Jazz Shelley. She injured her ankle last night in the game early. Maybe she can play Sunday. I don't think you want to hobble Jazz Shelley playing Creighton. I think you want a healthy one, a healthy Jazz Shelley. I don't think you want a hobbled one. So, like, if she can only go out there and play 50%, she's not a post. So, you know, Creighton does a lot of stuff outside the arc. I don't think you can be a quarter step slow against what Creighton does on offense. So I think it would be iffy to see if Jazz can play. And of course, Annika Stewart, she could play. She's day to day. She's a post. So maybe you can get, you know, 7 to 10 minutes from her. Maddie Kroll's been out. And then Allison Widener obviously is hurt. So it's a little bit shorthanded. As I wrote in my midweek column today, I don't know that it's completely impossible to beat Creighton if Jazz Shelley doesn't play. I think they can win it. I think they've got a couple of defensive players they didn't have last year, Darian White and Natalie Potts. I think those players will give Creighton trouble. And we'll see. You know, we'll just have to assess it. Not that Jazz is the best player on the team, to be clear. She has not played great against Creighton, and Creighton is not a team that is easy for a player like Jazz to play well against. They play a certain kind of defense, and they're well coached and well conceived, and they would take Jazz away. And they forced Jazz into some tough shots the last 2 years, but she hadn't made a lot of them. And there were a lot of them were far out, 23, 24 foot shots. They're just they're challenging in that way. And the best way to beat Creighton is to have some of the players that I think actually Nebraska has in Darian White and Natalie Potts. Defensive minded players, players who can get deflections, slow Creighton's offense down. They're going to have to get a good game from Alexis Markowski, who's got maybe the toughest assignment of the bunch. Alexis will have to cover Emma Ronsick, who has had good games against Nebraska and is just a hard cover. She's 6'2" from Sioux Falls, where you're going this weekend, and can shoot the three, can come out. She can screen. She's just a really, really good player. And then that doesn't even start with Morgan Malley, who will probably be covered by Potts and can do a lot of things. I mean, she can post up, she can jab step you, she can back you down. It's a lot of things that Morgan can do. She's an elite player. And probably maybe a second or third team All-American candidate. So Morgan's a tough one to stop. I like Creighton in this game. I think they got a better team. I think they got better starters. And we'll see. You know, Nebraska has only won one of these games since Amy Williams has been the coach.
Yeah, I mean, I think you kind of laid out the roadmap for how Nebraska wins this, if it does, which is a kind of, you know, grittier, tougher game, you know, not a particularly pretty game, but, you know, a game where, like, Darian White, Natalie Potts are able to kind of disrupt things. You know, I don't think Nebraska wins a sprint against Creighton. You know, I think it has to be, you know, if they win, it'll be because they kind of slowed it down, played good defense, and made it, you know, limited the possessions.
Yeah. We'll see. Creighton's number 22 in the country. That's one of their large non-conference games. They'll have a good crowd on Sunday for that one. Gerald Starhandle covering that one from a writing perspective. Okay, let's talk about Nebraska now. Casey's back. Juwan Gary will be back.
Presumably, it's been a little vague. Yeah, who knows? We'll keep asking about him. And,
yeah, well, it's a violation of team rules. Maybe the team rules has an expiration date.
Yeah. Ramel Lloyd is back, assuming his dad's tweet this morning was accurate.
Okay. So it's gonna be hard for Ramel to find a spot in the lineup.
Yeah, yeah. We'll get to that, but yeah,
it's gonna be hard. You gotta be healthy.
Yeah.
No. Thing doesn't wait for anybody. So let's talk about the rotation. Pretty much everybody's back except for Blaze Key to them. Am I forgetting someone? I don't think I am.
No.
You can't play them all. Fred said it. Now, Fred doesn't usually say stuff like that, but he said it in the press conference, right? You just can't do that.
Yeah.
So what do you think it looks like? Who do you think that, I don't know. Let's say they could go to 10. Oh, no, I'm sorry, 9. Who are the 9, you think?
Well, I think based on what we saw against Ryder, Eli Rice appears to be the guy whose minutes got limited with Casey coming back. Played a little bit in the first half, knocked down a corner three-pointer. The knock on him has always just been he can score, he can make shots. He's got to defend at a more consistent level than he has these first couple of games. And he was the guy who, I don't have his numbers up front of him, but he, after being a pretty regular in the rotation the first two games, he did not play quite as much. So I see him as kind of the odd man out at this point. As for who the 9 are, so you got your starting 5 from the other day of Tominaga, Lawrence, Williams, Alec, Mast. CJ Wilcher was very good as the 6th man. You figure when Gary's back, he will be in there. He might be possibly starting. I think he brings a kind of similar skill set to Alec. It's kind of defense, physicality, rebounds. That's 7. I feel like I'm missing some obvious ones here. Sam Hoiberg will play as the kind of defense energy guy. And okay, we're at 8.
Have you named Boogie yet? Boogie Coleman?
Boogie. Okay, yes. And Boogie. Yes. I think those are the 9. Rice is a guy with a ton of potential. And, you know, I don't think it's like this crazy notion to think over the course of the year he could play his way into more minutes, especially if he gets better defensively. But I think for now, that's those would be the kind of main guys that are going with the 9-man rotation.
So one thing, a couple things here. One, you know, Eli Rice, can he drive? Can he go by anybody?
Not sure we've seen it yet. We've seen some athleticism, but I don't know how like applied it is, if that makes sense.
That does make sense. So yeah, Casey obviously is going to be part of it. When you go through the minutes, you see that there's 9 guys averaging double digit minutes, and Coleman's one of them. I'm sorry, Rice is one of them, but Juwan Gary will return, and then he becomes the 9. Maybe you go up to 10. I don't really know. I think one of the questions with Rice is just, okay, yes, defense, but can he get by people? Like, you're playing a team like Ryder. Is that team, you know, I mean, they're going to come out and guard you. And yeah, you can run to a spot, and guys were running to spots and shooting threes, but you know, could Rice dribble by them? CJ Wilcher's dribble game has gotten better. It just has. And I would almost make the argument he's been the best player on the team so far this year. Very close to it. Rink match.
I don't think that's unreasonable.
I think Rink, CJ, and I mean Jamarcus Lawrence is selfless, but he isn't making shots yet. I mean, Jamarcus Lawrence is not going to make 18% of his threes this season, but he needs to not make 18% of his threes. Not making shots yet. He needs to make shots. Right now he's hitting 21% from the floor. And that's something that needs to get worked out. Bryce needs to get worked out. He needs to finish better at the rim. And he's shooting, let's see here. Well, he's shooting okay from three. He's 38% from there. Wilcher is 43%. And that's kind of where they hoped he would be last year. And he was not. And we'll see if that part continues. It'll be interesting to watch. Obviously, defense is super important. And some of those guys that I just rattled off aren't elite. defenders. Juwan Gary is. So he's going to play. And I guess we'll see what happens from there. What can you tell me to end this off? What can you tell me about Oregon State?
Oregon State, they're they'll be Nebraska's first real test, and by real I mean like a high major school. They were not fantastic last year. That might be underselling it, but it'll be Nebraska's first time playing guys who were recruited by similar schools to them. I think there's a interesting setting that it'll be in South Dakota, which I understand often ends up being effectively a home game for Nebraska. Still a weird place for Oregon State to go, but I think that'll be the first, assuming Nebraska doesn't fall flat on its face against Stony Brook tonight, this will be the first kind of real major test, first time where we'll really learn something about this Nebraska team, I think.
So I believe, if I'm not mistaken, let me see if I've got this right. Oregon State went to the Elite Eight as a 12 seed 3 years ago. And when you look at the guys that they had on that team, there was a lot of seasoning. There was a lot of experience. They were playing a bunch of guys. They weren't a high scoring team that year, but they won a lot of games close, and they beat Tennessee and Oklahoma State. They beat Loyola, which I believe beat Illinois in the second round. And then they lost by 6 to Houston, who then went on to the Final Four. Kind of a defensive-minded team. That was in 21. And then the next year, they went 3-28. They didn't have a lot left. So they lost some guys left. Their defense fell apart. They didn't really stop anybody. And then last year, they kind of hit the reset button, right? Yeah. And they played a bunch of freshmen. And the freshmen were pretty good. And they went 11-21. And now this year, those freshmen are sophomores. Jordan Pope, Tyler Bilodeau, I don't really know how to say his last name. Christian Wright. Casey Ibekwe, they're all sophomores. And it seems like a pretty good team. Like, even though their record last year was not anything to write home about.
It's kind of a transitional year, like you said, last year. And, very... It's different from Nebraska, a team that has really built through the portal over these past few years. It's kind of a longer term, more gradual, holistic approach. And has Oregon State played anyone this year notable? Well, I can't think off the top of my head.
They've won two overtime games. They beat Troy 81-80 in two OTs, and they beat Appalachian State 81-71 in one OT, and then they beat Linfield, which is a school in Oregon. So no, they
didn't. So similar to Nebraska's early season schedule at this point.
Oh, I'd say yes. I mean, I think Troy's probably better than any team that Nebraska's played up to this point.
Yeah,
usually teams in the Sun Belt are more competitive than Ryder is in the first two teams Nebraska played for. Obviously competitive at all. So I'd say the Sun Belt is a little tougher, but and then I think Appalachian State's in the Sun Belt too. Right?
Yeah.
I don't know. Not really. No. But they've got, like you said, high major players in it, they were in the NCAA tournament 3 years ago, and they went a long way in the NCAA tournament. So, there's some institutional fortitude there. Not really sure why they're playing Nebraska in South Dakota. Let me see. Let me look at their roster and see if somebody is from South Dakota. Maybe that would explain it. Nope. No one is. So there you go. Just making a trip out to Sioux Falls.
Saw the opportunity to play in the Sanford Pentagon and took it.
That's what it was. I'm guessing somewhere in there might be a trip to Oregon State, Nebraska's future. Maybe an Oregon State trip to Nebraska. I don't know. They played, you know, the two teams played each other in a home-and-home series back when Craig Robinson was head coach, because Craig Robinson, the brother of First Lady Michelle Obama. And so they had a, I think Doc was there. I can't remember. It was a long time ago. Doc or Tim, early Tim Miles era. Maybe it was late Doc era. They played Oregon State. 1-1, lost one. Oregon State wasn't very good. So, and then Tinkle, I believe, took over for Robinson. And then I think his son was on the first NCAA team. So they've been to the NCAAs twice under Wayne Tinkle, I believe. So, you know, more success than Nebraska's had in the last 20 years as it relates to those things. They've been to the NCAA tournament twice under Wayne Tinkle, who was previously the head coach at Montana, where they went to the NCAA tournament three times while he was there. That's all the news that you ever wanted to know about Oregon State. Gary Payton's kid was on Tinkle's first NCAA tournament team, as was his son, Trace Trinkle. Trey Trinkle. Doesn't make a difference.
Probably the most notable Oregon State basketball alum, Gary Payton.
Pretty sure. Awesome. Pretty sure he is. You like Nebraska's chances in that one? I assume they're going to be favored. I don't know. What does KenPom say?
KenPom has Nebraska winning 72-63.
There you go.
Which I think that's fair. I think that's reasonable. You know, there's definitely some talent with the Oregon State team, but they're also, I think they're a year or two away. I think, you know, this is the kind of game, you know, I think Nebraska kind of built its roster to win, you know, at the, you know, early season neutral site. You know, it's a team that won't kind of have its routine thrown off, any sort of that stuff from, you know, playing in a different venue, different routine, different lead up to the game. I like Nebraska in this one by, you know, I think 8 to 10 points.
Okay. Well, it's your first road trip. Take care of yourself up there. Yeah. Wilds of Sioux Falls. Just got to make sure you don't get off the, you know, never know. Don't get off I-29 too fast. That's the interstate that takes you to the fine area of Sioux Falls and the Sanford Pentagon. You'll have to give us a full report on the throwback nature of that arena. It seemed pretty cool, to be honest.
Wasn't there another game in there just not too long ago?
There's games in there every year. Yeah. A lot of them. Yeah. I think the most famous game played there, Gonzaga played there against Memphis in a year when I think both teams were really good. That was many years ago. So I don't really remember the context of that, but yeah, it's like an old school gym, you know, like an auditorium style gym.
Yeah, I've seen pictures of it.
Nebraska beat Oklahoma State there handily a couple of years ago. So apparently Augustana plays there. Augustana College, which is in NAIA. I don't know what – I think they're NAIA, right?
Oh, they're D2.
D2.
Yep. Yeah, it's their gym, and that's also where the they play in the NSIC, the Northern Sun Conference, and that's where they have their conference tournament every year too.
Well, there you go. Fun stuff coming up with Nebraska and Creighton basketball. You know, the Jays, I think we'll have a podcast, a brief one next week. The Jays play again this weekend. And then next week they play in Kansas City. I don't know what to tell you about that. Those games, they're playing Loyola, and then they're going to play either BC or Colorado State. Not sure they're going to struggle in any of those games. I think Iowa's a better team than all three of the teams I just mentioned. So I think they've had their early test, and then they'll get a few more here coming up. Okay, Wilson, enjoy Stony Brook tonight.
Oh, I
For
plan to.
Wilson, I'm Sam, and that's our Half Court Press podcast.